Folks, the video that keeps on breaking up in front of you, which we were trying to play for you, is a video from Platform 67, the mission organisation that I mentioned last week. Even if some of the words just keep playing through, it's amazing the statistics that are on it about how much of the world hasn't heard the gospel, doesn't have the gospel. Platform 67 is the mission organisation that we're collecting for at our drop-off day this coming Thursday. So just watch the last of that as it plays through. Hopefully if it'll play even without the music, and you'll see some of the facts and figures just before we start. And as you said before, church things are so quiet, sure it's not. There's no chit-chat and all. Folks, it's amazing just when you see some of the stats on that about how much the world isn't churched, hasn't got the gospel, hasn't been spoken to, and even the world, they don't have enough Christians within their own country to be able to tell others about God. So the work of Platform 67 is so important. So this Thursday, that's our mission topic on our drop-off day. So on Thursday from 10 till 12, we're going to have our drop-off. I haven't got the list of what they need, the most up-to-date list. The last I heard from them was they particularly need tinned meats and even Frankfurter sausages, anything like that to go with pasta and rice and the sauces that they're in. If we can target those particular items, and again, if you have any other church envelopes to drop off on Thursday, please do so. We don't have very many announcements, just to say that I'm actually going off on holidays as of this afternoon for the next 2 weeks. So any pastoral issues that come up within that time, please contact Fiona or your elder or Barbara in the church office, and there is support in place for anybody that needs it. In relation to that, one pastoral issue that did come up, I regret to have to announce that yesterday or on Friday evening that Mr. Bertie Russell passed away suddenly. Bertie would have been 93 yesterday, so just shy of his 93rd birthday. Our thoughts are very much with Susan and with the family at this time. So let's just pause and let's just pray for Susan. Father, thank you again that we are gathered here this morning as a church family. And as a family, Father, we very much are thinking of Susan at this time. Lord, that Bertie's loss maybe will not register with her because of what she has going on, but we think about the rest of the family at this time. Just ask that you be near to them and close to them. Lord, we thank you that Bertie is now at peace, he's at rest with you. There's no greater place for him to be, but it's hard for those who are left. So Lord, just be with them and help them this incoming week. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. There will be a service of thanksgiving sometime this week for Bertie. We're not quite sure when that's going to be yet, because with it happening at the weekend, we can't get any arrangements made. Reverend Andy Gilbreth, my friend from Westchurch, is going to actually be taking that service for us. But if you stay in touch at whatever stage, as usual, with social distancing, it'll be difficult for us as a congregation to gather in, because it'll have to be family first. But if anyone does want to stand outside to support the family, that'd be very much appreciated. But hopefully come Monday by about lunchtime, they should have that date organised. So if you're on Facebook, keep a wee eye and that'll get put up. And if not, phone the church office and Barbara will be able to let you know. Now for the fun part of doing the birthday blessings. First of all, is anyone too warm today? It was a very cool day yesterday, wasn't it? If anyone does feel the effects of the heat and you do need to make a sudden exit or you need a bit of assistance, just touch somebody beside you, because I know it is warmy. And even with the heating off and even with doors that were open earlier to try and get a bit of air through, it is still quite warm within this building as well. So if you do need any help, please just shout to somebody beside you and we'll be there for you. Birthdays. I only have a couple of birthdays to mention. There's one I missed last week, which was Amy Crossman. It was her birthday yesterday. For this incoming week, we have Ethan Hiles. He's turning the same age, 17. And then there's a small birthday in our house. Our son Luke has his birthday today as well. So let's pause and let's give thanks. Father, thank you again for today, again for being able to celebrate birthdays as a church family. Lord, for Amy and for Ethan and for Luke, we thank you for them. Thank you for this milestone of another birthday. I just ask that you would continue after them and bless them for this incoming year. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Just in case anyone's really observant and you look around, you see some people wearing t-shirts and they all look like they're wearing a uniform. Well done, well spotted. We're going to come to that later on in the service. That's a little bit of exciting news and something to give you a bit of and prayer on this week. But I wonder what your week has been like. You know, sometimes during our week we have great days and some days we have bad days. And it's all about how we encourage one another and we help each other. There was a verse which went up onto our Facebook page, I think it was possibly Friday or yesterday, I can't remember now. And it said these words, slightly different because this is the New Living Translation. Worry weighs a person down, an encouraging word cheers a person up. You know, what we're about today is about encouraging one another as we meet together to worship. It's about handing over our past week to God, handing into his hands what lies ahead of us so that he can come alongside us and he can encourage us. So, Phil, can we put the words of the first verse up on the screen? These are words which I'm sure you will know. They're old words. It's an old hymn, but the words are tremendous. Guide me, O my great Redeemer, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but you are mighty. Hold me with your powerful hand. We come to worship our God who has his powerful arms around us. So let's stand and let's praise him as we sing these words together.
Oh,
You know, that hymn is all about God guiding us and leading us, about his plan for us. And that's about what we're thinking about this morning, right the way through from the children, right the way through into what we as the adults are thinking about how God guides us and leads us. So let's come to our guiding God right now. Let's talk to him and let's pray. Our dear God and our loving Heavenly Father, thank you that you have gathered us here this morning. Thank you for the opportunity to throw wide the doors of the church, to have our music playing, to be able to sing praises to you, to be able to recognize you as our great God, the one who loves us and who cares for us, the one who has a plan for us, the one who puts his shield in front of us, his arms around us, the one who is always there for us. Lord, as we sang that I am weak, we recognize that we are indeed weak. We don't have the strength that we need each day to stand up for you. But because of you, you give us that strength that we need, and you help us. So, Father, thank you for that. Lord, as we meet here in person, we remember those who are watching this morning, and we give you thanks for them. We remember those who cannot be with us this morning, whether they be off on holiday, whether they be ill at in hospital, whether they just, through age, they just cannot make it here this morning. Lord, as we worship you here, may they have that real sense of your presence with them, that your love is surrounding them, that your arms are holding them close, that they would know your peace and comfort. So, Lord, thank you that we are here this morning. Continue with us now as we worship and praise you, for it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Don't think I actually said this morning, but good morning, everybody. It's lovely to see everybody here this morning. It's even lovely to have some children with us here this morning. So thank you for making the effort to come along. Would you rather be outside playing some games? Yeah? Well, don't worry. In about half an hour's time, you can bolt out those doors and get a bit of sunshine again. Who's got a paddling pool waiting for them? No? Who's going to jump under a hose and get wet? Maybe. Yeah? Cool drawing. Well, it's funny I should mention water, because water comes into this morning's story. So I said to the adults, and they said to everybody there, that this morning's all about how God guides us and leads us. In the Old Testament, you've got a group of people at one time who are called judges. Now, it sounds very scary, sounds very formal, but it's a group of people who God called to help his people and to lead them to, you know, the word judge, it's not so much judge, but it was to help them in times of trouble. And one of them, well, I wonder if anyone's looked at their sheet. Can anyone guess the name of the one from this morning? Gideon, well done. See, Gideon and water come together. You see, Gideon was a very nervous person. None of you would be nervous, sure you wouldn't? Definitely not. Gideon was really nervous, and when God told Gideon that he wanted him to lead his people, he sort of thought, God, you've got it wrong. You couldn't possibly want me. I'm not very good. So he decided to ask God to show him that he really wanted him to lead his people. So he got something called a fleece. It's basically like the wool you shave off a sheep. And he placed the fleece on. He said to God, if you really want to lead your people, see in the morning, can you make the ground dry and the fleece wet? And he woke up in the morning, guess what? The ground was dry and the fleece was wet. Right, Gideon sort of thinking, well, hang on a minute. The ground thick and heavy by the fleece is, so maybe the dew just hasn't dried off the fleece. So he said, God, I know I asked you, but can I ask you something else again? He said, God, to make sure I really understand that you want me to lead your people, see tomorrow morning, can you make the fleece dry and the ground wet? So the next morning, what do you think? Hannah? Yeah, the ground was wet and the fleece was dry. The morning before, he was able to pick up the fleece and wring it out and fill a basin full of water. And then the second morning, the fleece was bone dry, but the ground was wet. So Gideon goes, okay, God, got the message loud and clear. I know you want me to lead your people. So there's a big battle coming up. Anybody like watching fight sequences on TV? Yeah. Do you think you're in the army or you're going to battle away? Sometimes. Well, there was a great big gathered for Gideon to help him fight the enemies. And God said, you've got too many soldiers. Now, who has ever heard of an army saying you've got too many soldiers? It's daft, isn't it? You can never have too many soldiers. But God said, you've got too many soldiers. So he said, look, tell you what, tell your soldiers, if any of them are feeling a bit frightened, tell them they can go home. Do you think any of them went home? No. They did. 20,000 of them, and only left them with 10,000. Isn't that an awful lot of soldiers who went home? And what do you think God said then? Do you think he said, battle? He said, you don't have enough soldiers. He said the opposite. He said, you've still got too many. Imagine that. Tell them they've still got too many soldiers. So, who's been thirsty in this hot weather? Well, those soldiers were thirsty as well. So, Gideon had to take them down to the river and get them to drink. And God said, how they drink. Some of them might get down and lie down on the ground and get their heads into the water and drink all they want. Some of them might scoop the water up and, a bit like a dog, lap the water from their hands. So Gideon watched them. And there was only a couple of hundred of them who scooped the water up in their hands. And what do you think God said? James, keep them. That's it. They were only left with a couple of hundred soldiers, and the rest of them had to go home. The reason that they did that was because when it came to the battle, God wanted them to realize it wasn't them who was in control. It wasn't them who would win the battle, but it was God who would win it for them. So they went down to the camp, and they had trumpets in one hand. They had these burning torches in the other hand, and they'd covered them with jars. And at the right moment, they broke the jars in the ground, and they shouted, and they blew their trumpets. And all the soldiers and the enemy got so frightened, they all ran away. And they won the battle. They won it not because they had lots and lots of soldiers, but they won it because God had a plan, and God was in control. And you know, for you and I, boys and girls, and for all of us, God has a plan for us, and God is always in control. We just need to trust him. Haven't we got a great God? Haven't we got a great God? Yes, we do. Who loves us and who cares for us. So let's sing about that great God. We're going to try and sing a piece which didn't work a couple of weeks ago. But boys and girls, there was none of you here to help. We just had to bypass it. It's a song called God is Good All the Time. Now, you definitely have to stand for this one. And there are some actions if you're feeling brave enough to do the actions.
Yeah.
boys and girls, and for the adults as well who helped. Have a seat. Have a seat, but I'm going to ask some people to stand. So if you've got a Summer Blitz t-shirt on you, can you please stand? Don't be shy. Thank you. Now, folks, have a wee look around. For the folks up at the balcony, you'll not be able to see the people here tucked back there, but you'll see some of the folks here down here. Yeah, Janet, yeah, you came a wee bit late, didn't you, to get that on you? The Summer Blitz is happening this week. Now, if you're wondering what the Summer Blitz is, it's a programme which is happening for our young people on Wednesday, Thursday and Friday. Our BB were able to apply for a grant to get funding to be able to get our young people re-engaged in different activities. So it's going to be a fun week, Stephen, isn't it? Stephen, come up here to the front of this microphone here in a second. Just keep me right, because you know me, I'll get something wrong here. So we've been asked to pray. So if you go onto our website, you'll see our prayer points for the week very much include and very much feature upon our Summer Blitz. So Stephen, Wednesday, Thursday and Friday, you're going out and about?
We are. Wednesday we start here. We are actually changing our main car park into an outdoor gym. So we've got a boxing trainer coming to work the kids for an hour and a half. Then they'll be fed here and then transferred to Groomsport to do a new sport called foot golf.
Yes.
Or Groomsport.
Happy days.
So that's Wednesday. Thursday we are paddle boarding in Bangor Marina, right beside the big pier. So there's good spectator area. So if you want to come along and see us all getting drowned. Janet, are you wearing your t-shirt properly? paddle boarding at Bangor Marina at about 2 o'clock for an hour. Then we're walking all the young people around to Crawfordsburn, so we'll get a bit of exercise. Might be a treat on the way. Then we'll get fed at Crawfordsburn, and then some beach activities in the evening. And then Friday, we're going for a full day down to an outdoor education centre in Killalay. So we'll do some dry sports and some wet sports, kayaking on Strangford Loch and whatever. And finishing up here with a barbecue at tea time on Friday.
Brilliant. I'm sure now there's a lot of adults down there going, I wish I was coming as well. As you can see, there's a number of our adults and some of our young people as well, which is great. But we've been asked to pray, particularly for when you listen to all those activities, let's pray for safety for our young people, for our children, for our adults as well. Let's pray for them as they reconnect, that they would really enjoy this time together. It's been a long 15 months for everybody, but particularly for them. Let's pray for our leaders, that they have the energy to keep going, and the patience as well, and for everybody who's volunteering with the catering and such like as well. Let's pray for good weather, that it stays dry, and just the fellowship of the different organisations come together. But most importantly, let's pray for God's love to be shown to all of our young people. Stephen, thank you. So that's, as a congregation, let's pray for that outreach. Folks, you can have a wee seat as we do this. Father, we are so grateful for all the opportunities that you give to us to be able to reach out, both within our church fellowship and further afield in that as well. Lord, this Summer Blitz is all about reaching out. It's about helping our young people and our children to reconnect, helping them to see how much you love them and care for them. So we pray for these 3 days. Lord, we pray for good weather. We pray for safety as everyone comes and goes. We pray for safety as activities happen. We pray that our young people and children would have a really good time, that they would thoroughly enjoy it, that they would go home tired in the right way, Lord, and ready for the next day and what it brings. But the most important thing of all, Lord, that they would see just how much you love them and how much you care for them. Father, we thank you for the enthusiasm of our leaders. We thank you for the gifts and talents that you have given to them as they lead and as they look after and as they guide our children and our young people. So, Lord, put your arms of protection very much around them and help them. Give them eyes in the back of their heads this week as they look out for everybody. Just be with them and give them the strength that they need. And may they be a true blessing to those who they're interacting with. And, Lord, as it's happening and as it's happening in different places where people can see us, may this also be an outreach opportunity, that maybe somebody would come along and ask what Summer Blitz is, and we can say that it's your church reaching out to those who need it. Father, thank you again for this. Thank you that we are here this morning, and Lord, please continue with us. And Lord, thank you for the gifts and for the offerings that have been brought. We ask that you would take them and use them to your glory and to your honor. For it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Thank you to all those who are volunteering to help out within this 3 days of Summer Blitz. It's really important. So folks, please go onto the church website and you'll see the prayer points there. Church website's really easy to find. It's just strain.org, really simple address, and you'll see it on the front page where we have the announcements and the prayer points. So please have a look at that and keep praying for this week. Let's come and read God's word together. We're going to read from 1 Samuel chapter 9 and then from 1 Samuel chapter 10. We're going to read a few verses in chapter 9 and then some verses in chapter 10. So let's hear God's word. 1 Samuel 9 verses 15 to 17. Now, the day before Saul came, the Lord had revealed this to Samuel. This time tomorrow, I will send you a man from the land of Benjamin. Anoint him ruler over my people Israel. He will deliver them from the hand of the Philistines. I have looked at my people, for their cry has reached me. When Samuel caught sight of Saul, the Lord said to him, "This is the man I spoke to you about. He will govern my people." And then 1 Samuel chapter 10, verses 20 to 25. When Samuel had all Israel come forward tribe by tribe, the tribes of Benjamin were taken by lot. Then he brought forward the tribe of Benjamin clan by clan, and Matri's clan was taken. Finally, Saul, son of Kish, was taken. But when they looked for him, he was not to be found. He has hidden himself among the supplies. They ran and brought him out, and he stood among the people. He was a head taller than any of the others. Samuel said to all the people, "Do you see the man the Lord has chosen? There is no one like him among all the people." Then the people shouted, "Long live the king!" Samuel explained to the people the rights and duties of kingship. He wrote them down on a scroll and deposited it before the Lord. Then Samuel dismissed the people to go to their own homes. Amen. We ask God would bless this reading of his word. The very first slide that we have has words which I'm sure you will know and you'll recognize. "Your will be done." Those are words that we say whenever we say the Lord's Prayer. "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." You know, whenever we think about "your will be done," some people might start and argue with us. Because as Christians, we firmly believe that we have free will. And there's a number of words up there which all relate to free will. And yet, whenever you try to say, "But God," whenever you say God's will, "your will be done," do we really have free will? Or is our free will more like this, where we think we have free will, but God's really pulling the strings? That's not who God is. God knows everything. God knows what our reaction will be. God knows how things will work out. That's why we can say that there is always God's plan. This passage and the passage which follows, and the story of Saul and what he's like at the beginning and who he becomes, God's plan is right the way through that passage and through that story. If you think about God's plan for his people, he wanted his people to be different. He wanted the Israelites to stand out among all the nations of the land. He wanted them to be a people who didn't have an earthly king, because they have the best king, a heavenly king. And yet, the people rejected God, didn't they? They turned their backs on him, and they said, "We want a king." And yet, have God in that passage, as he talks to Samuel, as Samuel is in despair, saying to Samuel, "Look, I've heard the people and given them a king. Don't worry, I still have my plan." God is still in control. And God shows that plan to Samuel as he identifies Saul. And so God shows Saul to Samuel. He tells him about a situation that's going to happen. He says, and watch out for this man. That's who's going to be king. And lo and behold, just as God says, everything happens. But I have to laugh, and if you come to that second passage that we read this morning, Saul is chosen, and where is he? He's hiding. Now, let's be honest. Which of us, if we were told we'd been chosen to be king or queen, how many of us would run away and hide? It's a daunting prospect, isn't it? You're going to govern these people. You're going to be the ruler. They're going to come to you looking for leadership, looking for judgment. Now, don't forget, before this bit we didn't read was, it talks about how the Spirit of God had come upon Saul. But Saul still had that choice. Will I stand up and be king, or will I run and hide? But because of what had happened earlier, the Spirit of God came powerfully upon him. Saul said and stood forward and said, I'll be king. And the people cheered, long live the king. They wanted to recognize the fact that they had a king. People thought that their will was happening. They thought they were getting their own way. But yet in the midst of this, God still has his plan. Now, the story of Saul is really sad. Saul at the beginning is a great king. In fact, the argument could be made that if you take his early kingship, he's the best king that Israel see. Because he's not taking things from the people. He's not being hard on them. Whenever he's first anointed king, he goes back and he works his own land. Yes, there are men who get so excited and they want to support him and they go with him. But he goes and he serves the people. And whenever there's people who are rumoring against him and talking against him and refusing to support him, and he could have had them thrown in prison, even worse, he could have had them put to death, he doesn't. Saul just says, leave them be. So the argument can be made at the start that Saul is the greatest king that Israel see. But unfortunately, things go awry. Because Saul started to do his own thing. He started to turn his back on God. He got impatient. Whenever Samuel tells him to wait, he can't. Whenever he says, I'm coming, Saul gets anxious and goes on ahead himself. He takes an offering and he makes an offering himself. He brings the ark out without asking, without having God's guidance. He does so many different things. And his kingship starts to fall apart. And yet, God still has a plan. Even as Saul rejects God and rejects his leadership, God has a plan. And here's the really sad thing for Saul. Now the Spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul. He falls so far. He gets so far away from God that God takes his Holy Spirit from him. And instead, it says that God gives him a spirit to torment him every day. Now maybe that spirit's reminding Saul of just what he has done wrong. Maybe it's reminding him about how he has failed and all the things that he's done that he shouldn't have done. We don't really know. It doesn't tell us too much. But Saul ends up being a tormented person because he turns his back on God. And yet, God still had the plan. The plan for his people. The plan for his people to be different and to be able to reach out. You know, in all of this, Saul could have turned back to God. In all of this, Saul could have said, God, I am so sorry for my behavior. God, I repent of what I have done. I really want to be the leader you want me to be. But he doesn't choose to do that. You know, you and I are a bit like Saul. At times we follow God very closely. At times we listen to him. At times we want to do everything the right way. At other times we want to go off and do our own thing, don't we? Let's be honest. At times maybe we don't want to wait for God. We do want to wait for that leading. We do want to wait for how he wants to guide us. And we get an idea into our own head and we want to go off and run with it. And maybe we do. And maybe we start to see that the blessing doesn't come because we haven't followed God's will. We haven't followed his plan. We forget that God always has a plan for us. We do have free will. We have the choice to follow God or turn our back on him. We have the choice to live for him or not live for him. And even as we do live for him, we have the choice of following the path that he has chosen for us. Do we follow that path or do we go off our own way? Do we know the blessings that God has for us or do we reject those blessings? And one day have to answer for that and go our own way. In all of the story of God's people, God always has the plan. In the story of Saul, I'm sure so many of us know that David gets anointed as being the next king. And that really winds Saul up. Because then he realizes God really has rejected him. But God didn't reject him just on a whim. It was Saul who rejected God. It was Saul who turned his back on God. And yet God still has the plan for his people. And God still follows through that plan for his people. But Saul chooses to remove himself from that plan. Saul chooses not to trust God, but to go off on his own path. And that's the same as true for you and I. God always has a plan. For our lives, God has a plan. For our church, God has a plan. For this town, God has a plan. For the world, God has a plan. But you and I have a choice to make. The choice is, will we follow that plan or will we go off on our own way? It's a bit like when you think about church life. God wants all of us to be involved in church life. There's lots and lots and lots of different jobs that need to be done around this place. There's lots of callings which God puts upon us. There's lots of gifts which God gives to each and every one of us. And you have that choice whether to use that gift or to bury that gift. Now, if you use that gift, you will know God's blessing. But if you bury that gift, God's plan doesn't stop. God's plan doesn't suddenly grind you a halt because you've suddenly chosen not to do what God has gifted you with. God's plan carries on. But you don't have that blessing. You miss out on so much. And God doesn't want any of us to miss out. He wants all of us to know that blessing. Think of the blessing, face mask on. We're actually singing together. Isn't it lovely? Isn't it really nice being here? Isn't there just something different about coming in together as people? And the blessing of that. If you're watching this from home and you haven't yet dipped your toe into coming back into church, I would encourage you, please come back into the building. We've still got plenty of space. And the distancing will be dropping over the summer. The government have told us that, and PCI have told us distancing will be going, and we'll be going to every other pew. And that's exciting for us because it means we're more of us gather back. But the blessing of being here, the blessing of worshiping God in this place, it is lovely. And to hear the hustle and bustle of the voices before and after church, it's great. And it's just, you can't describe what it means just to be here. That's knowing God's blessing. That's following God's plan. That's being what he is doing. But the big question is, in all of that, will you trust God? Will you trust that God has the plan? Will you trust that God knows best? Will you trust that he knows what he's doing? And will you get involved with it? That's the challenge that we face daily. the challenge which we have to put upon ourselves. I can preach it till I'm blue in the face up here, but you've got to challenge yourself about how much you trust. You've got to examine your own and see, what does God mean to you? Think about what He's done for you in the past. Think about what He wants to do for you in the future. See just how much He wants to be a part of your life and how much He wants you to be a part of what He is doing. Just think of what it's like to use that free will to follow God. May God bless you. May God challenge you. May God encourage you. Let us worship God as we sing together the words of our... Can we put the words up on the screen again, Phil? Come, people of the risen King, the King who delights to bring Him praise. Come all and tune your hearts to sing to the morning star of grace. We have a great God who wants us to follow Him, who wants us to worship Him, who wants us to be involved. Let's worship and praise Him now. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with us all forevermore, we pray. Amen. Folks, thanks for being here this morning. And as we leave church this morning, please just remember to keep a wee bit of distance, but please feel free to head outside and to catch up. Just remember, I'm off the next couple of weeks, so if anything comes up, please, Fiona is there, give her a shout, or contact your elder if there's an issue. Or if you can't get any of those, or you're not sure of phone numbers, then phone Barb in the church office and she will get the message through. But take care and God bless.